Recently, I've been getting into a World War II shooter called Hell Let Loose. While playing a tank crew member, I expressed I had no idea what I was doing. I was asked by one of my squad mates, "So, how much do you know about World War II tanks?" In a joking reply, I said, "Well, I've seen Fury." We laughed and he said that was actually a fair depiction of how these tanks work, both in the game and in reality. Then I got to thinking about how Fury has this utilitarian, realistic depiction of a squad in a World War II setting, as opposed to something like Saving Private Ryan. Is that a realistic depiction in terms of squad dynamics?
Mr. Captain, what about you? I mean, you don't gripe at all?
I don't gripe to you, Riven. I'm a captain. It's a chain of command. Gripes go up, not down, always up. You gripe to me, I gripe to my superior officer, so on. I don't gripe.
Maybe, but then I was thinking about those two movies overall. Their tone, themes, aesthetics, and plot. They're quite different, right? Why is that? How can we have two very different depictions of World War II when often it is seen as something sort of clear-cut in American discourse? Think back to grade school. What was World War II? Nazis are bad because they are bad, America comes in and we are smarter, faster, better, stronger, boom, win the war. It's simple and clear cut, right? When diving into just these two movies alone, you begin to realize it isn't so clear cut. They certainly depict the Nazi military as abhorrent as they were, but they also express very different themes and ideas about ourselves. We discuss on this channel how we can see films, music, TV shows, and games as reflections of larger cultural ideas, conversations, and perspectives. Our cultural products are a manifestation of our current tensions, joys, anxieties, loves, and/or occurrences. So what can a staple genre like American World War II cinema reveal about how we view war, conflict, global relations, and ourselves? That's what this short series will be about. Welcome to Analysis with Alex. This is a YouTube channel that aims to take the typical video essay format and transform it into longer running units for you to pursue cultural studies interest with. Think of this channel as the film class or literature class you never got to take because it didn't really fit into your requirements or that you didn't get to go to college at all. That's why I'm here. Sadly, I haven't been able to record the next unit, Sociology and Film, the way me and my wife have been planning slash want to, so it's on the back burner for now. But I wanted to get something out there for you guys. So this video will be the first in a brief series observing American World War II cinema. If you enjoy this video and content, please subscribe so that you can join up on future explorations. Go follow me on Instagram to get updates and sneak peeks. With all that out of the way, let's look at some early World War II movies. Arguably, the roots of what we are exploring find themselves in American propaganda during World War II. Cinemas were a staple at this point, and film was a useful tool to maintain support for the war effort, share information, and encourage certain forms of activism, such as rationing. Though Hollywood was certainly sympathetic to the Allied cause, its overall goal was still to entertain and turn profit. Therefore, the war was often used in the background of movies. The most notable example of this would be 1942's Casablanca. Depictions of war and the war effort remained mainly to more informational films. These would play at cinemas in between films often. The most influential and well-known of these would be Why We Fight, funded by the US Department of War and directed by Frank Capra, who you may know of uplifting film fame with It's a Wonderful Life and Mr. Smith Goes to Washington. These films sought to educate the public on the war effort, counter enemy propaganda, and according to Capra himself, create one powerful idea. In his autobiography titled The Name Above the Title, Capra states that his overall goal with Why We Fight became to, quote, "let the enemy prove to our soldiers the enormity of his cause and the justness of ours." I find this interesting as we start to head into more fictional or quasi-fictional narrative-driven movies involving World War II. Propaganda films produced during this time already began to craft the iconography and narratives we see through popular war films. Audience members would already be situated to feel and think certain things when presented with certain images or dialogue or settings or topics. And not because those feelings are unjustified, but because this form of media already tapped into the cultural consciousness of America at the time. They all end up playing off one another. To give an example, when I see a picture of the landing at Normandy, known as D-Day, I might think and feel similar things that I feel when I see the opening to Saving Private Ryan, or vice versa, or the mission in Medal of Honor Frontline. or the Omaha Beach map on Hell Let Loose, or the sequence depicting these events in The Longest Day, all of these working with one another, reminding me of each other. This series of signifiers will become important to understand the early part of American World War II cinema. I want to start this series by looking at the 1960s, which features quite the collection of World War II movies, especially some big names like The Longest Day and The Great Escape. I want to start here because America's relation to the war at this point is just coming off the back of a loss in the Korean War, something rarely ever discussed in American cultural discourse, and the tensions surrounding the Vietnam War. In fact, starting with The Longest Day may be a good film to use. Released in 1962, and starring the likes of John Wayne, Henry Fonda, Robert Mitchum, Sean Connery, and Richard Burton, The Longest Day provides a stylized, narrative-driven look at the D-Day landings at Normandy. Keep in mind how iconic some of these actors are, especially John Wayne. That will be important later. One of the most intriguing things about The Longest Day is its use of docudrama style. This already harkens back to the Why We Fight newsreels and other propaganda films at the time. The movie identifies its characters with subtitles involving their name and rank, locations with timestamps, and the black and white cinematography certainly evokes the sense at times that you are watching footage similar to that of the newsreels of World War II. Take a look at some of these aerial shots of the Normandy invasion. There is an attempt in The Longest Day and other World War II films of the time to try and capture the scope of war. These shots are pretty epic, even by today's standards, and capturing the scale of war is something we are going to discuss throughout this small unit. But keep in mind, during the 1960s, war was big, and it was epic. Let's look at another scene real fast. One of my favorites is when the Germans first witness the Allies embarking on the Normandy invasion. As a joke, which we'll get into in a minute, you can see a German shepherd already, quote, abandoning ship at the start of the scene, as if it is actually the first one to sense the oncoming turmoil. The scene that follows utilizes a soundtrack and close-ups of the Germans to convey the idea that the Allied military was seen as an unstoppable force. It is a scene where you're supposed to nod at the anticipation that the Allies are about to obliterate the Axis. It is a sort of catharsis at the impending attack. There's also something ironically very Apocalypse Now involving the soundtrack and tone of the scene. But let's save that for another time. And of course, the German high command is shown as not even rugged or honorable enough to be near its troops, as the commander is off sipping tea in a lavish building. I point out all these creative decisions as they are seen across a few different films of this time. Before moving to another movie though to compare, I feel like I have to point out another rather interesting thing. There is humor in this movie. Later films we explore might also use humor and comedy, but more in a sense of realistic banter between soldiers. The Longest Day features scenes that are clearly designed to utilize humor.
Well, what did he say?
The answer is no.
Ah!
We have to use the damn pigeons.
I've got these ready. Here, clip this off.
Going the wrong way. Not towards the Germans, you idiot! The other way! The other way!
Damn traitors!
So what we've witnessed in The Longest Day is the use of similar aesthetics from Why We Fight and other media and propaganda employed in the US during World War II, cinematography that frames the epic scale of war and combat, intentional creative decisions to frame the Allied forces as an unstoppable force, and intentional creative decisions to create humor within the film. From here, I want to focus briefly on a couple of other films, Where Eagles Dare and The Von Ryan Express. I actually want to observe the trailer for Where Eagles Dare rather than specific scenes though. Similar to the use of John Wayne, Henry Fonda, and Richard Burton in The Longest Day to already ascribe certain values and ideas to each character, Where Eagles Dare does the same with Clint Eastwood and also Richard Burton again. In Where Eagles Dare, we see rugged British and American men undergo an epic covert mission to a spooky castle to rescue a captured general. It should go without saying that this is a thrilling adventure full of double-crossing and quick-witted action. It's an action-adventure film that utilizes the star power of its actors to already ascribe the values of heroism, self-determination, and honor to the allied characters. The Von Ryan Express accomplishes a similar outcome. This time we have Frank Sinatra, though, who leads a group of mainly British POWs on a daring escape mission. Once again, rather than watching some scenes from the film, let's watch how the film was marketed. If you go and watch the trailer for yourself, just know that it has some truly awesome voiceover work.
Who does this cocky, overbearing Ryan character think he is?
I'm the ranking officer here, Major. What I say goes. Is that clear, mister?
You better know what you're doing, unless you want a mutiny on your hands.
Why do 600 prisoners of war hate him worse than Hitler?
You get your eye crossed now, Von Ryan!
Is this man they call Von Ryan traitor or hero? How does he turn a prison hell train into his own highballing headquarters for his private war against the Nazis?
Once again, Sinatra's star power already situates this protagonist as a rugged American that is more heroic, innovative, and determined than others around him. Humor is used again, and the scale is large and epic with insane action sequences. This is also, once again, showing other forms of combat outside of infantry combat. There's more of a focus on the plotting, espionage, behind enemy lines escape mission instead of men storming a beach. You can see how all these films borrow attitudes and ideas from one another, even though The Longest Day's black and white cinematography works to ground it more so in its very real subject matter than the technicolor of these other films. Alongside our takeaways from Longest Day, the movies Where Eagles Dare and The Von Ryan Express situate the American cultural consciousness toward World War II in the 1960s as a period where American soldiers embraced the values of rugged self-determination, individualism, and willpower to get the mission done and not let anything faze them. All these films harken back to the images shown in the media during the war, like Why We Fight, all while another war is occurring, one that is being presented in popular media in a far different light than World War II was. We've laid this foundation so we can see how World War II has changed over the course of popular American cultural discourse. Most viewers of this video probably already know that more recent World War II films explore the time period and events in a far different manner, not to mention how video games have changed how this war is perceived in American culture as well. All this is not to say that the themes present in these films are wrong in any way, rather it is to call attention to how World War II, and thus war in a general sense, was being perceived by so many Americans for such a long period of time. There were deliberate measures taken to alter how Americans viewed their military and war at the time. The most forward-facing cause of this effort is the suppression of legendary film noir director John Huston's 1946 documentary, Let There Be Light. Towards the end of the war, there was concern raised about veterans being able to adjust back into society and day-to-day life despite the experience they just went through. At the time, what was called shell shock or psychoneurosis frightened many people, and veterans faced the stigma returning back home. These conditions are now more commonly referred to as post-traumatic stress disorder, or PTSD. The Army Signal Corps tasked Major John Huston with producing the documentary to show no one had anything to fear. However, as Huston visited various Army hospitals with very willing subjects, including both patients and doctors, a concern about the demoralizing effects the film might have on post-war recruitment began to rise as the final cut was being made. The documentary's exploration of soldiers' feelings about, quote, a sense of impending disaster, hopelessness, fear, and isolation did not portray the United States military as the unfazed, hardened, unstoppable power that the aforementioned films do. The military police and War Department worked to confiscate any copies of the movie. They also refused to give any copies out. It wasn't until the 1980s that Let There Be Light was released. Huston claims in his autobiography that the military wanted to maintain a warrior myth around the American soldier. He believed they wanted the public to believe that a young soldier gets sent to war and comes back stronger and better than ever. The aforementioned films show that everyone is a hero and pay little attention to the casualties and mental illness caused from war. Let There Be Light only focuses on the casualties. In fact, the original name of the film was intended to be The Returning Psychoneurotics, but Huston changed the name during production to Let There Be Light, which is derived from Genesis 1:3. In the Message translation, it reads, quote, God spoke light, and light appeared. God saw the light was good and separated light from dark. Houston believed that he was separating light from dark with his film, revealing difficult truths that others were too scared of at the time. You can actually watch Let There Be Light in a few different locations online. I encourage you to, as it's pretty short, and it's interesting to see how Houston plays with light and framing in an interesting way, like he used in the classic The Maltese Falcon, and he would later use in The Treasure of the Sierra Madre. I will link the National Film Preservation Foundation's page for it below. So let's recap what we've covered so far. Many aesthetics for war during the 1960s derived from popular media outside of films, like news media or propaganda. These aesthetics also aim to create the scale of war through aerial shots and huge wide angles. There's a utilization of icons and star power to ascribe certain traits to the American soldier, such as heroism, self-determination, ruggedness, and an honorable ability to be unfazed. Infantry combat is not focused on so often, as more adventurous missions take center stage, and signs of PTSD, trauma, hopelessness, and isolation are pushed to the side, if not entirely suppressed. In short, the only casualties and negative quality to war thus far is the loss of life in an honorable way. With that foundation laid for America's cultural views on World War II, the next video will examine how these aspects changed moving forward into the 1980s. Or more specifically, it will focus on the absence of World War II films in the 1980s in general, and it will speculate why there are barely any 1980s World War II films at all. Thank you for watching this video. If you enjoyed this video or you like content like this, then please subscribe so you can join up on future explorations. Let me know in the comments what you thought of this video, and let me know if you noticed anything else about these films that I didn't touch on. Feel free to follow me on Instagram to get updates on the channel as well as my reading habits of 2021. Once again, thank you for watching, and I will see you all in our next exploration.